Don't ask me what you know is true. Don't have to tell you.
Stand with me, please. Open your Bibles to the book of Matthew. As you do that, our children are dismissed to their classes. Matthew chapter 6, we are continuing in our series, praying service. Thank you. Prayer service. Matthew chapter 6. And we will begin reading in verse 5, Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5. And once our kids are out and the doors close and it gets quiet, we'll read the word of God. In Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 5. When you got it, say so. And Jesus says, and when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who sees, who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. And then Jesus says, in this manner, therefore pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Lord, I can't speak for anyone else in this room, but when I read these words on forgiveness, my heart trembles. There's a weight in these words, God. There's such a great offer that you give us to experience and extend forgiveness, Lord. But not just that, Father, but there is a responsibility that you place upon us to forgive. And so, Lord, this morning, as we dig into this text of Scripture, as we look into the truth of your word, I pray that our hearts would be drawn closer to you. I pray that as we sang this morning, Lord, that you would bring healing to our hearts as we allow you to wash us clean. You told your disciples, as Peter said, Lord, if you need to wash me, wash my whole body. And you told him that he was clean because of the word that was spoken. And yet he still needed to be washed. His feet needed to be washed. And so do we daily, God. And so I pray that you would wash us afresh and that you would give us new hearts in this area of forgiveness, Lord. I pray for brothers and sisters in this place, Lord, that have unforgiveness, that have issues in their hearts, that they have not allowed you to address, that they have not allowed you to deal with. Lord, may your word penetrate deep into their hearts this morning. May you yank out unforgiveness this morning. May you heal brokenness this morning, Lord God. May you break chains of bondage this morning. May you free people this morning, dear Lord. Father, open ears that have been hardened and deafened to your truth and to the call that there is to forgive, Lord God. I pray, dear Lord, that you would do a mighty, mighty work in each and every one of our hearts today. That we would experience, that we would extend this forgiveness. In the mighty name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. If you do not have an outline, would you just raise your hand? And that way the ushers can get you an outline. We want to be sure that you have an outline, that you're able to follow along in the introduction of the message, but that you're also able to take notes as we continue through this message here today as we speak on the topic, forgive us. We are again in our series, Prayer Service, because we believe that we should serve the Lord out of a posture and out of a position of prayer. Again, we do not have an issue with repeating the Lord's Prayer verbatim. However, we do believe that the prayer that we are reading here is one that Jesus gives us for us to follow as a model for us to pray, but not also to pray, but also as an understanding of the values that we should have as followers of Jesus. As followers of Jesus, these things that Jesus tells us to pray for, we should see them as things that matter to him, things that are important to his kingdom, things that are important to him as our God, as our Savior, as our Lord, as our leader, as the Father of the family of God. He wants us to think, he wants us to live a certain way, and so he gives us this outline. And so this morning we are coming up to a pretty intense portion of the text, and we'll focus mainly on verse 12 and 14 and 15, where Jesus says, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." And that seems kind of easy, kind of, and especially the first part, you know, forgive us our debts. It's normal for us to want to hear that or to pray that, right? I don't know about you, but I daily, multiple times throughout the day, I'm asking God, forgive me. Every time that I sin, I am asking the Lord to forgive me. Sometimes mid-sin, hallelujah. Even though I may continue on, you know, with the foolishness or the stupidity or whatever it is, I realize, man, I got to ask for forgiveness because this was dumb. This was something that was not God honoring, the thought or the words or the action, whatever it was. And so I use this often, but I don't always connect it with as I forgive those who are sinners against me, or as I forgive those who have debts that they owe me, right? I don't pray that part. And then I definitely don't think about verse 14 and verse 15, for if you forgive men, it's like Jesus says this and then he just focuses on one point of the whole thing. He doesn't expound any other part of this prayer, but in verse 14, he jumps into, let me expound what I just said. In case you missed it, in my Father, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, let me jump down. Let me just make sure you understand what is being said here. What is being said here is for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. See, there are very few subjects, this is in your outline, there are very few subjects as sensitive to discuss than that of forgiveness. It is such a deep heart issue and difficult to navigate at times that we would rather ignore the need to deal with it than dig in and follow our Savior, who from the cross declared, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Think about that. The first words out of Jesus' mouth after he is flogged, after he has carried his cross, he is dehydrated, he is depleted, he is bleeding, he is bloody, he has been nailed to this cross. And the first words out of his mouth as he's looking upon those who have hung him on that cross, as he is looking at those who have declared, Lord, crucify, or declared, crucify him. The first words out of his mouth are, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Is that your posture when people offend you and hurt you? Is that how you think? Like, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Stephen, when he is being stoned, he asks the Lord to forgive them. Again, another one who is being brutally beaten for the glory and the honor of God. And that is the response that is there. So church, this should be our response. Is that we should want to be those who forgive, but when we get offended, we get hurt, we hold grudges, we're bothered, we can't look at people in the eyes because they've hurt us. We see them and something inside, I want you to hear what I just said. We see them and something inside of us. I didn't say you, because I'm right there in that boat with you where there are some times, man, I see somebody, I feel a certain way, and man, you know, I mean, my goodness, I'm 47 years old, so I've been hurt a few times. To add to that, I'm a leader of a church. I've definitely been hurt a few times. Hello. But we're called to this place, so we're supposed to forgive things, forgive people. Two things are true, and there's a little typo here, but two things are true. Each of us needs forgiveness. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. Each of us needs forgiveness. And let me point this out. Daily. Now, contrary to what you may admit to or be aware of, right? Those are two things, because there's some people, I've met plenty of people that don't think they need daily forgiveness. I've met plenty of folks that for some reason, I mean, I preach this type of sermon multiple times, and when I get in here and I start talking about we need to repent daily, they're like, well, do I really need to repent daily? I said, I don't know what kind of life you're living. Hallelujah. I know me, and I know that I don't walk on water, and I know that there are multiple times throughout the day that I know that I have sinned against the Lord. But here's the other thing, that this is the other thing that you got to know about yourself. There are ways that we sin against God that we are not even aware of. There. Go back to Leviticus. I'm not going to take you back there, but there's an offering for sin that is just, it's a just in case offering. Hello. just in case I sinned against the Lord and I don't even realize it, I'm going to offer this sacrifice. Because none of us is as holy as God is. None of us is as pure as God is, and therefore we need daily forgiveness. We need daily cleansing. We need daily purification. We need to daily acknowledge before the Lord, Lord, forgive me. I may not even remember. And see, I'm going to be honest with you. I say this for the person who doesn't really remember. When I lay in the bed at night, I can remember every single time that I sinned against God throughout the day. Now, what I'm not saying I remember every sin I committed against him. I'm saying I remember every time that I have sinned that I'm knowledgeable of throughout the day. Like when I lay in my bed at night, I know I didn't communicate the gospel with somebody that I should have. I didn't act the way I should have in this situation. I think about I lay down in the bed and I'm like, Lord, I want my conscience to be clear. I want to make sure that I didn't go through, what I'm saying is, I'm not ignorant enough to think that I know every single sin. What I'm saying to you is, there's some people, again, that I've met that they're like, well, I don't know that I need to repent every day. Okay, well, I'm just letting you know, you did sin some way in that day. You did. Just know that. Just know it in your heart that you did sin against the Lord. Now you may have had 5 minutes of good, hallelujah. You may have had, you might have had 60 minutes of good. You might have had 12 hours of good where you didn't sin. Maybe, I don't know. I've never made it that far. I'm just saying. I've never walked in holiness that much that I can say, well, I've had all of these hours where I haven't sinned against. I mean, there are times that I'm focusing on stuff. I'm not getting up doing anything. And I think like when I'm studying scripture, you know, things like that, like in those moments, I don't think that I'm sinning against the Lord. The point is, God is holy, we are not. That's the point. The point is, God is holy and we are not. But so the first thing is true is that each of us needs forgiveness daily. And the other second thing is that none of us has the right to withhold forgiveness from anyone. You should highlight that. You should underline that. None of us has the right to withhold forgiveness from anyone. Now, if we sat down and we got down and dirty, we could sit down and we could express how we have been sinned against, who has sinned against us, what they did, what they owe us. We could go through that. I have a list. Hallelujah. I'm sure you do too. Of people that you're just like, man, I don't trust them. You know, I don't want to deal with them. We have those relationships. We have those situations in our lives. But what I know for certain is that there is no one that I have a right to withhold forgiveness from. Now, this portion of scripture is such an intense portion of scripture. Commenting on it, Charles Spurgeon, who was known as the Prince of Preachers, this is what he says concerning this portion. Unless you have forgiven others, you read your own death warrant when you repeat the Lord's Prayer. Let me say it again. Unless you have forgiven others, you read your own death warrant when you repeat the Lord's Prayer. Felix, my mentor, he calls this spiritual suicide. When you pray, not the first part, again, Father, forgive us our debts. That's like normal for us. But most of us do not connect our petition of God for forgiveness with as we have forgiven our debtors. I mean, if I were to ask you to raise your hands, I don't want you to raise your hands, but if I were to ask you to do that, I'm pretty sure most hands would go up in this room and you would say, no, when I ask God to forgive me for my sins, I don't connect as I forgive those who have sinned against me. Most of us don't do that. Because most of us, we just want the forgiveness, right? We don't want the responsibility that comes with it. So here's my big idea. I want you to think about this. I said half of it earlier. Forgiveness is foundational to our faith and must be experienced in its giving and receiving. I'll say it again. Forgiveness is foundational to our faith and must be experienced in its giving and receiving. God doesn't just want us to experience forgiveness from Him. He wants us to experience forgiveness of others. He wants us to experience it. There is this transaction that happens when I release somebody from the debt they owe me. When I say, you don't owe me an apology. You don't owe me that money anymore. You know how many relationships are destroyed over money? But imagine, I love, you know, when someone comes to me and they're like, hey, can I borrow this? I'm like, man, babe, do we have this? Because I don't want to lend it to them. I just want to give it to them because I don't want to expect it back because they may not pay me back. And then I'll be thinking about that every time I see them. Be like, yeah, I thought you were going to pay me back, you know, and I'm the pastor, right? So I got to be happy and I got to smile with you and I got to act like everything's all good. But I'm thinking in the back of my head, doggone it, man, you owe me money. What's up? So true, I'm like, listen, so that's just free right there, y'all. Someone comes and asks you, hey, can I borrow this? Be like, no, you can have this. Just free them right there and free yourself, glory to God. Right? Like let me bless. You know what, Lord? If I have it and they, then glory to God. If I don't have it, man, I'm sorry. But the reality is there's a freeing that happens. There's an experience that happens when we join the Father in forgiving those who have offended us. And God wants us to experience the freedom that there is, knowing that our relationship with Him is right, but also the freedom that there is, knowing that our relationships with others is right. Now, I want to say this. If you haven't heard me say this yet, I will say this again later on, but forgiveness isn't easy, but it's necessary. Forgiveness is not, I'm not up here saying, hey, this is an easy thing to do, y'all. Just turn on a switch, forgiveness switch. There it is. No. This is a difficult process. So the first thing I ask you to repeat after me is this. Say, forgiveness is a promise. Father, forgive us. You're good. That's all right. I like that. Father, forgive us. Father, forgive us. Why do we come to God with confidence when we pray, Father, forgive us? Why do we do that? Because we have been taught about the work of the cross. We have been taught, for God so loved the world, the Father so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, right? That whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We understand this principle of God's love. This has been ingrained in our hearts. We came to Christ because we understood the magnitude, the depth, the width, the breadth of his love for us. And so we come to God with confidence because forgiveness is a promise. If we confess our sins to God, he is faithful and just to do what? To cleanse us of all unrighteousness, to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. If we come, this is a promise. This is a promise. So there is a confidence that is there. In our Reaching Others course, we learn the sacrifice of Jesus. Christ takes away our sin and restores us in God's love. The verse that is associated with this is 1 John 4:10. And this is love, right? Not that we love God, but that God loved us and he sent his son to be an atoning sacrifice or a propitiation, depending on which translation you have. The King James has propitiation. However, some translators don't like the word propitiation. They like atoning sacrifice, and here's why. Because the word here is hilasmos, which it means, it's the means of forgiveness, the means of forgiveness. Propitiation, the reason I don't like that word propitiation is because it makes it seem as though there is a point that God is not on the side of you being forgiven. As though there's some point that God doesn't want your forgiveness. But the reality is the reason why God is able to tell us to love our enemies is because he perfectly loves his enemies. Because even though, and notice this, you are God's enemy. It's not that he's your enemy. It is that you are his enemy. You are the opposing party. He's opposed to you when you are doing things unrighteously. But even while you're his enemy, see, he's not worried about you because you are not that strong. Hello. You know, when you have an enemy, you know, you check them out and make sure, okay, can I take this enemy? Or, you know, because if they try to come at me, I got to be ready for that, right? Like, you know, that's how guys think. Ladies, maybe not. I don't know. But here's the thing. You know, you think about your enemies. You think about, okay, this is the person that is opposing me, right? But with God, his enemies are a joke. Hello. Like, okay, really, you're my enemy? Okay, yeah. He laughs at us, right, in that sense. But on the same side of this, while you are on your way to experiencing God's wrath, God in his mercy, in his grace, and in his love is always in the position of desiring your forgiveness. Therefore, he sends his son to become the atoning sacrifice, to become the means of our forgiveness so we can walk in and we can experience his forgiveness. Psalm 103, right? What does it mean when we say, Father, forgive, forgive us? That word forgive, it means to send away, to remove our debt, to make it non-existent. Psalm 103, it tells us in verses 11 through 12, it says, for as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. That's what God does. That's what God does for his people who fear him, his covenant people. He removes our sin from as far as the east is from the west. They never touch. They're far opposed to each other. They never come together again. That's what God does for our forgiveness. So what do we see from the Old Testament to the New Testament? God's forgiveness is not something that we earn, but it is something granted that is based upon his great mercy. Father, forgive us. Not just forgive me. Father, forgive us. Again, we know, right, that there is the personal application of give us this day our daily bread, right? There is provision for you as a person, but there is a mindset that is not just about you. There's that individual and communal side of this. And here's what I want to say, is that we should be equally concerned with the sins of the body as we are with our own sin. The latter, we being our own sin, because it affects our relationship with God. The former, because it affects God's image. See, the sins of the body, the sins of the church affect the image of God. Anytime that you as a believer sin against somebody else, you are distorting, understand this, you are distorting the image of God. When you lie to somebody, you are distorting the image of God because God is not a liar. When you are hateful towards someone, you are distorting the image of God because God is a God of love. When you are unwilling to forgive someone, when you are nasty and you are harsh and you are rude towards someone else, you are distorting the vision of God. You are distorting the image of God. And so we should be concerned with the collective sin of the body as well as our own sin. We should care about that. Father, forgive us. Look, when we sit down and we pray, we should be broken over our own sin for sure, because it breaks our fellowship with God. But we should be broken over the sin of the church. Those things should bother us. They should break our hearts when we see people falling in public ways that just make God. Listen, we live in a day and an age where everybody is looking at the church. You know why? Because the church puts all of its business on social media. And so whether we like it or not, what is happening is not confined to just the building or the four walls. It's out there for the world to see. It should break our hearts. There should be brokenness in us about the sin that is there. The second thing that I'll ask you to repeat after me is to say, forgiveness is a problem. Forgiveness is a problem. Father, forgive us our debts. Forgive us our debts. While forgiveness is a promise, there is a problem. And that is a lack of understanding of the depth of our debt. Here's where the problem is. We don't really get this. Romans chapter 6 kind of puts this in perspective. This word, I don't know if you remember when Dr. Pete came and he preached on forgiveness last year. He was preaching from this exact text. And he said, I don't know if you're a trespasser or you're a debtor, right? He was like, I don't know which one you are, meaning I don't know which translation that you remember. If it's, you know, forgive us our trespasses or forgive us our debts. And he said the word debts is closer to what the actual meaning of the word is, because there is a debt that has occurred. Well, how do we know this? Well, Romans chapter 6, verse 23, again, a verse that you know, the wages of sin is death. What we are earning for ourselves every time that we sin is death. Every time we sin, we earn death over and over. Are you here? Over and over. In reality, because we never stop sinning completely, we are always deserving of death. Do you get that? You don't just distort the image of God, but you are earning for yourself debt. That's what we're doing. Every time we sin, we are earning wages, right? The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. God offers us this thing, this eternal life. Well, you know, when we think about debt, what do I mean? Well, you know, whenever I talk about marriages and I talk about the bank account, that love account, hallelujah. For those of you who are married, you can appreciate this understanding, right? Well, whenever you do something good, you are making a deposit, hallelujah. But anytime you sin against your spouse, you are making a withdrawal. And here's what you want to do in marriage. Again, this is marriage counseling 101, so just take this. Maybe a reminder. But when you are in marriage, here's what you don't want to do. You never want to come to a place where you are making a withdrawal and there are no funds in there. Hello. You don't want an NSF in marriage. Hello. You don't want to bounce checks, right? You don't want to do that. You want to be a consistent and constant depositor of good in your marriage. You want to do good. You want to serve. You want to love. You want to honor, right? That's what you want to do in relationship. Well, here's the thing. This doesn't just apply in marriage. This applies in relationships, period. Because in relationships with people, it's like that whether you're married or not. You offend somebody, you hurt somebody, you are doing what? You are making a withdrawal on that relationship. And so now you have this debt, and it comes to a place where if you're not loving, you're not gracious, you don't care. Well, guess what? There comes a point that people are like, I'm done with you. Why? Because you keep withdrawing, you keep offending, you keep dishonoring, you keep disrespecting, you keep on acting in a way that doesn't honor God. And so ultimately we want to be on the side where we are making the right deposits. But we have to realize this. The problem with this sin is that, man, we are constantly accruing a debt before the Lord. The problem with forgiveness is that it's not free. Hello. Someone has to pay the debt for that sin that we are accruing. Although God offers forgiveness because of his mercy, there still remains the debt that we owe. And so what do we see in Romans chapter 6 and verse 10? For the death that he died. He died to sin once for all. The death that he died to sin once for all. And so again, we know this promise, but the problem is we have to understand the depth of this. The reality of our sin debt should be so abundantly clear that we are humble, grateful, and devoted followers of Jesus. Now, we're going to come back to Matthew, but I want you to turn real quick to Luke chapter 7. I want us to look at this passage of scripture. I don't want to just tell it to you. I want us to read it together. Luke chapter 7, beginning in verse 36. Luke chapter 7. In verse 36, it's a familiar passage, but I want us to look at some of these familiar passages together. And here's what it says. It says that one of the Pharisees asked him, speaking of Jesus, to eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. Now, there's no doubt the Pharisees were always trying to trip Jesus up. Simon, who's this Pharisee here, he's not necessarily trying to come and have a meal with Jesus because he wants to learn from Jesus, but he's probably got some questions, and that's, you know, where it's at. But something happens in this story. And it says, and behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, doesn't say what type of sinner she was just a known sinner. When she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him, weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wipe them with the hair on her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now, when the Pharisee, I just look at this. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. And it's funny when I read this because I'm like, well, how did you, being this upright man, allow this woman into your house? Anyway. But you hear his condescension in his thoughts. And Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. So he said, teacher, say it, because Simon didn't know that Jesus was reading his mail. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? Now, I want us to pause because I want you to see the picture that Jesus paints here. He points out that there are two people who are debtors. And one of them owes more than the other, right, in this scenario that he paints there. But he points this out, and neither of them had anything with which to repay. Both of them were in the same boat. They both had nothing in order to repay the creditor, the one who was offering them the credit. Neither of them had anything to offer in this scenario. And Jesus says that he decides, the debtor, that he is going to forgive them both. And so Jesus asked the question, which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one who he forgave more. And he said to him, you have rightly judged. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair on her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. And those who sat at the table with him began to say to themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Then he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Now notice again, Simon is being rocked in this conversation. Because he doesn't offer, these are customary things that you did for your guest. You greeted them with a kiss, right? Like you gave them water for their feet. Why? Well, because they didn't have sneakers on like we do. Hello. So they're walking around barefooted or in sandals, dust and dirt and dung and all kind of stuff is all up in their feet. So when they walked in, and guess what? They didn't have chairs they were sitting on. So you know what you didn't want? You didn't want somebody with stank, nasty feet sitting next to you to eat. Hello. Jesus comes to this guy's house by invitation. Hello. Hey, come to my house and eat. No kiss, no water for my feet, no anointing, nothing. But this woman does something else. Why? Because what should happen in those moments, Jesus shows us that we should be humble. We should be grateful. We should be devoted followers of Jesus when we understand the depth of our sin. Jesus shows us the reality of our debt. We're all in debt. None of us can pay Jesus back for what we owe him. Hello. Brings me to my third point. Say this with me. Forgiveness is a process. Second part of that verse, Father, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us our debts. Lord, we have debts. We cannot pay them. But we ask you to do this on a condition. Again, we don't do this. We don't come to the Lord asking for forgiveness, thinking about those who are indebted to us. And I hope, I pray that this teaching this morning will change the way that you ask for forgiveness. I hope that every time you come to the Lord in a place of position of forgiveness, that you will come to him and that you will equally think about not just your sins against him, but that you will think about those who have sinned against you and say, Lord, I forgive them. Lord, I release them because I'm asking you to forgive me. I'm asking you to release me from my sin debt against you. And I'm not going to walk around holding them as though they owe me something because you paid the price for me. See, here's the thing. We realize forgiveness is a promise. That's why we ask him for this. Hopefully you see the problem of forgiveness. But the real question is this. Is Jesus suggesting that somehow we earn forgiveness by forgiving? Is that what he's suggesting? The short answer is this. That's a great question. That's a great question. Is Jesus suggesting that somehow, we earn forgiveness by offering forgiveness? In the expositor's commentary, D.A. Carson, he quotes C.F. D. Mole. He was a professor of divinity at the University of Cambridge. I just want you to know who he is. You understand this guy is a deep thinker. 25 years, he was a professor of divinity there. You don't just become a professor of divinity at Cambridge University. You don't do that. The guy is a brilliant mind, and in one of his books, he writes this. He rightly insists on distinguishing between, on the one hand, earning or meriting forgiveness, and on the other hand, adopting an attitude which makes forgiveness possible. You hear the difference? One of them is that we are somehow going to earn forgiveness, that we are somehow going to do something that is going to say, God, well, now you have to forgive me. The other one is simply adopting an attitude. Adopting an attitude that makes forgiveness possible. So when we come back to the scriptures, we have to understand just as we struggle with this teaching, so did Jesus' disciples. You'll notice this. You can write this one down. We're not going to turn to this verse. But in Luke chapter 17, verses 1 through 4, Jesus is talking about forgiveness. He is speaking to his disciples. If your brother sins against you and he comes back to you 7 times in a day and asks you for forgiveness, you are to forgive him. That's what Jesus says there in that text. And verse 5, the first thing out of the disciples' mouth is increase our faith. Why? Because we need a lot of faith to do what you just said. See, the rabbis in those days, they taught their disciples that if someone sinned against you up to 3 times, you would forgive them. The 4th time, no more. That's what the rabbis taught. Like someone came to you, they sinned, you forgave them. You forgave them again. You forgave them again. Oh man, you ain't serious. I'm not forgiving you anymore. You don't deserve forgiveness. Now, this wasn't a biblical teaching. This was them trying to interpret or apply the law in their context. But nonetheless, Jesus says, hey, if they come to you 7 times in a day, hello. Not in a week, not in a month, 7 times in a day. Someone does something messed up to you 7 times in a day, you forgive them. The disciples are like, Lord, increase our faith. Increase our faith. But here's the passage that I want you to turn to. I want you to turn to Matthew 18. Matthew 18. And again, we've already looked at this, but I think Matthew 18 helps us to see what Jesus is communicating here. Matthew chapter 18, and we'll look at verse 21. We'll start in verse 21. And it says this, It says, and Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? And so again, I just told you the rabbis taught three times. Peter is going to seven. So he's like, I'm really upping the ante here. Hello. And Jesus replies, I do not say to you seven times, but up to 70 times seven, 490 times. Whew. That's a lot. It's a lot of forgiveness. Now, some of you are going to be like, okay, Bishop, I'm going to write 490. And every time they sin against me, once they get to 491, they are done. I have met my responsibility. I have forgiven them 490 times, right? But you realize that when we look at 1 Corinthians 13, it says love keeps no record of wrong. Come on, Bishop. I thought it was just 490. Now you're saying I can't keep a record of wrong. Jesus wasn't trying to give them some equation to figure out, no, this is enough forgiveness. He was up in the end. He was saying, man, just you forgive. That is what you and I do. We forgive. And he goes on, shares this parable of the kingdom. He says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. I want you to understand, that's just a lot of money. He owed a lot to this king. 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. This is a beautiful story so far, isn't it? But that servant, now just pause for a moment. Let's say you owe somebody 10,000 talents. We're just going to say, for the lack of, you know, knowing what a talent was, $10,000. You owe somebody $10,000. And they come to you like, yo, you got to pay me. And then after you beg them, they say, you know what? Just forget it. We're good. And you're like, nah, for real? Yeah, for real. We're good. Okay. Are you going to be grateful? Now, but that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. Now, it's not about what the amounts are here. Just understand this. This 100 denarii was like a day's labor, right? So it's like 100 days labor here is what he basically had. So whatever it would have been for a day. This guy owed him the denarii. I didn't sit down and do all of this math. But the point is that the servant owed this other servant like way less than what this first servant owed the master. And he comes to him, he sees him, and he said, but that fellow servant found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat. Come on now. Saying, pay me what you owe. Now, you would think this dude would have been like so good. He would have been like, bro, you don't owe me a thing. He would have came to him and hugged him and said, you know what just happened for me? That ain't what happened. He walked out there. He's like, you owe me. So this fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw that he had done what he had done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that has been done. Then his master, after he had called his servant, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant just as I had pity on you? Let me read that again. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant just as I had pity on you? And this master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. I don't see in any of the passages that we've read a clause that says something like, this is just talking about temporal things. Meaning that this is only dealing with this side of heaven. You're forgiven and you're good. Don't worry about that. But on this side of heaven, you're going to experience suffering. You're going to experience hardship. That I don't see that in the text, my friends. And as a matter of fact, I read, you know, Augustine, who is like one of the fathers of the faith. And I read his message, his sermon on this particular passage. And nowhere did he ever give his hearers an out and say, listen, this is only speaking of temporal punishment and temporal judgment. And this has nothing to do with eternity. They never did that. I read other commentators, and one of them here, he says this, and this is D.A. Carson. Again, he says, Jesus sees no incongruity in the actions of a heavenly Father who forgives so bountifully and punishes so ruthlessly, and neither should we. Indeed, it is precisely because he is a God of such compassion and mercy that he cannot possibly accept as his those devoid of compassion and mercy. When you are forgiven and you understand how much you've been forgiven, that changes the way that you engage with those who sin against you. And if it doesn't, then there's something that didn't happen inside of you. There's something that you don't understand about the depth of your own sin. When you look at other people as greater sinners than yourself, there is a problem. When you can condemn others because of their sin, but you are not broken of your own sinfulness, there is an issue. You do not understand the depth of your offense against the holiness of God. You don't understand what happened on the cross. You don't understand that this isn't just some movie, you know, scene where Jesus gets beaten brutally and bloodied and then hangs on a cross, and you hear his, you know, the nails going into his body, and you see his body jerk when the cross is dropped into the hole. It's more than all of that. There was something that happened on the cross that was deeper than we realize. Our sin is an offense against the holy God, and the only way that we won't forgive others is when we don't understand that. We don't understand how sinful we really are. You know, a couple of weeks ago, Minister Hector, he was saying, you know, he was exhorting, he said, you know, some of us, we don't have this crazy testimony. We don't have that story like Bishop or, you know, somebody who, man, they were out there crazy, living foul, living ratchet. And so you don't really, you know, you don't think that your story really matters. My friends, a lie put Jesus on that cross. The lust of your heart, covetousness, put Jesus on that cross. Hatred for others put Jesus on that cross. Whatever minimal thing you think that is huge, that is what put Jesus on the cross. John Stott, he says something. He says, once our eyes have been opened to see the enormity of our offense against God, the injuries which others have done to us appear by comparison extremely trifling. If, on the other hand, we have an exaggerated view of the offenses of others, it proves that we have minimized our own. Here's the thing. I'll go on record to say this. I think what Jesus is saying is you can't be a forgiven person if you are not a forgiving person. You can't be a person who has really experienced the forgiveness of God if you're not willing to forgive those who have sinned against you. Now listen, I have a past. I know what it's like to be molested as a kid. I know what it's like to experience things that I didn't do anything to deserve those offenses. And while I would never trust those people with my kids or with anybody else's children, I do not harbor any bitterness toward them. I don't pray God's judgment on them. As a matter of fact, I pray God's mercy on them. I pray that they would one day acknowledge their sin against me, against my sister, against everyone else that I don't know, because trust me, we're not the only ones, but I pray that they would acknowledge their sin. But I don't pray, God, you know what, I'm holding that against them until they apologize to me. I don't have a right to do that. Will I trust them? Never. Will I hang out with them? Absolutely not. But do I hate them? Not at all. See, here's the thing. There's some sins, man, you did nothing at all to deserve, but you still have to forgive. You still have to release those people. You still have to say, Lord, forgive me as I forgive them. And I release them. I let them go. But see, those are extreme situations, because not everybody in every relationship is just, you're just innocent. Hello. See, a lot of times you're not innocent. You've been an offender as well as offended. It's just sometimes you think that their offense is greater than yours. I remember reading Gospel-Centered Discipleship, and one of the things that I recall is talking about marriage, and he said, man, the problem in many marriages is that you don't see yourself as the greatest sinner in the room. You see your spouse as the greatest sinner in the room. And that's why you hold them to such a high account, but you don't realize me, I'm the greatest sinner in the room. My friends, that's how we have to see ourselves. See, like the disciples of Jesus, you may wrestle with this. You may have someone you're struggling to forgive. Here's the exhortation. Don't settle for unforgiveness. Did you hear me? Don't settle for unforgiveness. Keep fighting. Every time those feelings come up, keep confessing. Every time they come to your mind, keep praying for that person until you love them. Hello. Oh, see, that, my friends, is the power of the gospel. The ability to bless those who curse you. The ability, Jesus says, to love your enemies. How do you do that? It's only by the power of the gospel. It's only by us reveling in the cross and what Jesus did for us. It's only by realizing, man, Jesus is so merciful to me. Listen, I know how I was before I came to Jesus, but can I tell you something? And this is totally honest with you. That's not as bad as it is after I've come to Jesus. Because here's the thing. Before I came to Jesus, I wasn't in a relationship with him. I hadn't confessed my sin to him. I hadn't asked him to come into my life. I hadn't said, you are Lord of my life. After I came to Jesus, oh, the little things, those are huge. Because I said, you're Lord. But every time I sin, I say, no, I'm Lord. Every time I dishonor God, I say, no, I'm Lord, you're not. Every time that I sin against the Lord, that's hypocrisy that is coming out. I don't want to be a hypocrite. I want to live for his glory. My friends, that's the reason why the cross is so important. That is the reason why we do not get away from the cross. There's nothing deeper. There's nothing more impressive. There's nothing more important than what Jesus did on the cross for our sin, laying down his life so that way we could experience his life, so we could experience his love, so we could experience his forgiveness, so we could go from being sinners and enemies of God to now being sons and daughters of the King. We don't get away from that. And so here's my closing question for you. Is your experience in giving or receiving forgiveness lacking in your life? Is your experience in giving or receiving forgiveness lacking in your life? Just bow your heads right there, please. If you would, stand with me, please. Keep your heart, your head just bowed before the Lord. I mean, seriously, is there someone that you need to forgive? That you haven't, that you struggled to? How How do I know? How do I know? When you think about that person, do you think they owe you something? Do you think they owe you an apology? Do you think they owe you money? Do you think they owe you something in some way? I don't know what it is, but when you think about them, you feel like they're indebted to you in some way. If that's true for you today, then you have to know that God is speaking to you about forgiveness. And whoever that person is, it may be multiple, but today is the opportunity to humble your heart before the Lord and release them from the debt they owe you. Maybe it's not somebody else that you need to forgive, but maybe it's yourself. Maybe you think your sins are too great for God to forgive. Maybe it's you understanding Jesus died to forgive you of your sins. So maybe it's not giving forgiveness, but it's receiving forgiveness that you struggle with. Now, if you're in here and you know that you either need to give it or you need to receive forgiveness, I just want to ask you to do me a favor. Just come out of your seat right where you are and just come forward. Let's pray together. Let's pray together. Hey there, thank you so much for joining us this Sunday. I hope that your time with us was helpful. Hope that your time with us was edifying to you. And I just want to say thank you for all of your support. Thank you for the likes. Thank you for the shares. Thank you for the comments. If you are joining us for the first time online, would you please do us a favor and either email me at bishop@corefaithchurch.org. That is bishop@corefaithchurch.org. So I can thank you for being with us, get to know you a little bit better. Or if you have a prayer request, you can also email me there. Or if you're on Facebook, you can go ahead and you can leave us a message here directly in the comment section, or you can send us an instant message and we'll get that and respond to you as soon as we can. Lastly, I want to say thank you to all of you for your financial support. And if you would like to contribute to Core Faith financially, there's a simple way to do it. You can give electronically. All you have to do is text Core Faith, that is one word, Core Faith to 73256. That is Core Faith, one word, to 73256, and then follow the prompts and you can be a financial supporter of the mission that God has given us. And if you are supporting us financially, I want to say thank you so much. I pray that God will bless you abundantly. God bless you. Hope to see you next week.